excellent preceding video asked, where were you during those 22 minutes? I know that at least one of you in attendance this morning was on board Piper Alpha that night, and I'm sure I speak for everyone when I respectfully acknowledge your presence with us here today, Harry, to reflect, review, reinforce and reinvigorate. Some of you might also have been working offshore that night on other installations, although it's increasingly more likely that you hadn't yet started your career. And some of you wouldn't even have been blessed with the gift of life yet that was so cruelly taken from so many on the night of 6th of July 1988. Like all other radio operators working the night shift on the many North Sea installations that night, I remember where I was. I'd not long begun my offshore career, and my lack of confidence appreciated the relative quiet that a night shift in the radio room would normally bring. I had little to do during my 12 hours other than prepare the reports that would be sent by telex the following morning, arrange the odd ship to shore call home for a fellow crew member, and observe the 3-minute silence periods on the international calling and distress radio frequency of 2182 kHz. These 3-minute silence periods, commencing every hour and half hour throughout the day and night, were allocated as such so that ships in distress with weak signals could be better received above the usual buzz of traffic that would otherwise be heard coming from the various stations transmitting within a radius that spanned hundreds of miles at night. 2 minutes of the period passed before the relative silence was broken by a concerned transmission to Wick Radio from the master of the Lowland Cavalier, broadcasting news of the first explosion on Piper Alpha. Thereafter, the radio operator on the Piper was heard sending a couple of alarm radio messages, and the whole horror of the disaster began to unfold. It was a long and harrowing night, and by morning, the magnitude of what had just passed was becoming ever clearer. Despite an armada of vessels searching the area, there weren't going to be any more survivors. The death toll was enormous. The burns and injuries to some of the survivors were horrendous. Although I couldn't sleep, I still lay in my bunk thereafter, numbed by the events from the previous watch, the transmissions on the emergency channel milling around in my head. I reflected on the panicked messages from the RO, bound by his duty to send the Mayday, and felt a deep empathy with his position. I dearly wished he'd managed to escape the confines of what I imagined the radio room in Piper to be. I wondered if he was one of the lucky ones, as few as they were. I considered what I would do in the same situation and how I might try and escape. And the very stark reality hit me hard that I'd chosen a very dangerous industry to work in. In respect of the 167 and the hundreds more before and since, it's an absolute honour for me to be up here today to talk about the importance of workforce involvement and safety. I'm particularly keen to address the safety reps amongst you in the hope that I can encourage you, or some of you at least, to become more effective within your function. There's no doubt we've come a long way since Piper, and the turnaround in our safety performance is notable. We've certainly become much better at managing the risks associated with the hazards that we faced 25 years ago, which are exactly the same hazards that we face today. Multiple billions of pounds have been invested to upgrade infrastructure, preventive barriers and mitigating measures. But to quote the late Bob Ballantyne, a Piper survivor who tirelessly campaigned for safety improvements offshore, this raises the question, just what sort of condition were these platforms in that this kind of money had to be spent? Today, we can measure the value of that money spent by the remarkable reduction in incidents and accidents since the 1980s. But the fact is, our safety performance has flatlined and offshore workers are still getting hurt. We still have potential for major events, particularly with the unplanned release of hydrocarbons. Therefore, more still needs to be done. We all know that it was an unplanned release of hydrocarbons that led to the Piper Alpha disaster, but it wasn't the cause. The cause lay much deeper, rooted within the safety culture of the industry at the time. The real challenge sitting at the very thin end of the wedge for us now is our continued development in this area. Workforce involvement or engagement, call it what you will, it's all the same to me, just may be the key to us further improving our safety performance. Traditionally, it has been the role of management to manage safety offshore, but I truly believe that if everyone offshore feels that they can actively participate with managing and improving their own safety, then we will see that trend moving south again. A knowledgeable workforce empowered with their own safety management will have the confidence to challenge where necessary, and that's what workforce engagement is all about. We've seen some great successes in this development already offshore. Of all the improvements in safety culture since Piper, the empowerment given to the workforce to stop the job, I feel, is our greatest advancement yet. It certainly wasn't an option in 1988, so as an industry, it seems, we really are learning. This is no easy fix, though. There are real difficulties with understanding and managing the many factors that contribute towards and restrict the development of a safety culture. Our industry is a very complex one, and wherever human beings are involved, there will also be complexity. But the more people that we can get involved and switch on to safety, and not simply because we feel we have to, but because we believe it's the right thing to do, then it will become increasingly easier to reach a point where it's simply the way we do things everywhere. We also have to be prepared for the long haul. The path that must be travelled in the development of a safety culture is a continuous one. And although milestones have already been reached, we'll always be required to reach more. I know it's cliche, but if our industry is to be measured as a whole, then we'll only ever be as strong as our weakest link. Therefore, everyone in every company, from their managing director to the new hire roustabout, needs to be encouraged to play their part. This point wasn't missed by Lord Cullen when he said, "It is essential that the whole workforce is committed to and involved in safe operations. The first line supervisors are a key link in achieving that, as each is personally responsible for ensuring that all employees, whether the company's own or contractors, are trained to and do work safely, and that they not only know how to perform their job safely, but are convinced that they have a responsibility to do so." Lord Cullen also had a vision of workforce engagement with a robust safety committee at the heart of the process when he stated, "Possibly the most visible instrument for the involvement of the workforce is a safety committee system." He also realised the importance of safety reps when he noted, "The representation of the workforce in regard to safety matters is important not merely for what it achieves in installations, but also for the effect which it has in the workforce, and showing that their views are taken into account and they're making a worthwhile contribution to their own safety." Some of you may be surprised to learn that there was in fact a safety committee on Piper Alpha the night it exploded, but it was a committee in name only. Being comprised exclusively of oil company staff, the bulk of the workforce, made up of contractors' employees, were unrepresented. Without training, and in the absence of effective regulations to protect and empower them, and without an effective enforcement agency in place at the time, the committee was wholly ineffective. Indeed, many reps had resigned in protest. Despite serious concerns from the workforce about safety in Piper Alpha, with its history of fire, explosion and industrial death, no effective mechanism existed for them to address the serious issues that eventually caused the disaster. This, combined with a company that paid only lip service to safety, made catastrophe certain. I firmly believe that if Piper Alpha had had in place the elements to support an active and functioning safety committee, then the disaster may have been averted. Before becoming involved full-time in safety, I'm very proud to have previously been elected by my peers to serve 4 full terms as an offshore safety rep, and I worked very hard at developing my safety committees during those 8 years. I've seen firsthand the SI 971 system working to great effect. Those committees that I was involved in were comprised of enthusiastic reps that were very much supported and encouraged by my managers. This didn't only apply to rig management, but also to senior management ashore. On the rig visits, they made a point of meeting with us, taking ashore with them any workforce concerns, and communicating back any progress to the committee in good time. That's workforce engagement. Although safety reps are essentially workers' representatives, good managers will realise that an effective safety committee is an invaluable tool in our aim to continually improve our safety performance offshore. and they will do all they can to support the reps and ensure continued development of the committee. All those experienced eyes and receptive ears, the cold face, so to speak, are very much an early warning system for issues that might cause problems later down the line. This transparency and communication between workforce and management is a vital starting point for developing the safety culture that a safety committee needs in order to function and flourish. It sounds a lot like the workforce engagement initiative that is being promoted today. However, even after 24 years of SI 971 being in place, many safety committees simply are not functioning as they should. And I feel we're missing a fantastic opportunity to make progress in realising the vision of Cullen. I believe that some elements of the industry, for whatever reason, still cannot see any value in the system. Some duty holders and some safety reps really need to try and do a bit more. You reps in attendance today are obviously committed to at least some degree, and I know a great many of you will be sacrificing time with your families to be here, and I thank you for attending. But how many of the reps in the same position as you do you know that are maybe not as committed as you are? Whilst a great deal of work is being applied by probably 10% of the safety reps in this industry, it's probably equally true that 10% of those elected will never ever do anything, no matter how hard we try and encourage them. It's the 80% in the middle that we really need to try and engage with now, the floating voters, if you like. Those who would probably be happy to do more if they were given a little bit more guidance and opportunity away from their work sites to attend to their function, as is required by law. However, no matter how hard a rep may work or try to make a difference, or how cohesive and hardworking a committee is, the effectiveness of our safety reps will depend entirely upon the level of training that he or she receives, a fact recognised by the HSE and the guidance for SI 971. I'm delighted that the reps of today are finally going to be given the chance to develop their skills through further training. Well done to my colleagues at the Workforce Involvement Group and others for their efforts in achieving this. Duty holders should now give their committees every chance to develop and provide the resources required to make this training available. Equally, reps will need to make sure that they do not miss an opportunity to use these skills to better effect at the work sites. 5 years ago, at the 20th anniversary of the pipe disaster, I had the courage again to stand up and address a large gathering of the offshore workforce. I did so in the hope that I might be able to ignite a spark of passion in some of those present and encourage better workforce involvement offshore. I've since learned that one of our colleagues in attendance that day, Willie Watt, did exactly that. He felt empowered enough to make a difference, enough so that his efforts were deservedly recognised by industry when he was awarded Safety Rep of the Year in 2011. Is there another safety champion amongst you today? If you believe you can make a difference, you will. If you're already a safety rep, encourage others to stand if vacancies exist in your committee. Work harder at developing your committee for the good of your rig. Enter into dialogue with management in the spirit of cooperation and mutual respect. Hold safety conversations at the work sites and never ever walk by an unsafe condition or unsafe act. Probably the biggest thing that we can all do to help each other offshore, keep us going home to our families every trip, is to perform these interventions where necessary. Learn about major hazards and develop an understanding of your installation safety case. Put forward a solid case to management to attend the additional training modules that are now available. Please, just get involved in any way that you can. In the following session, Jill Simpson of Step Change will ask you to get involved when she introduces you to the recently developed workforce engagement tool and ask you all to give her your full support in participating. Let's remind ourselves just exactly why workforce engagement and safety is so important. Before I stood up here in front of you today, we also had excellent and respectful production by Step Change, which has been developed to encourage us all to play our part, and also to remind us of the sacrifice that was given by the men of Piper Alpha. As poignant as it was, it did not fully convey the human element that surrounded the disaster. It did not tell you of the terror and the suffering that must have taken place that night, which we later learned from the survivors. I challenge anyone who who's not yet read the testimonies of those survivors to do so. If you do, you will learn of an incredible struggle to survive, where men were so desperate that they wrapped their burning heads in towels, that they dipped into the messroom aquarium and poured sticky black currant juice over their faces in a vain attempt to keep cool, while they waited to be rescued by a helicopter that could never come. You will read of men that found themselves trapped inside a food container and were so desperate that they squeezed the juice out of tomatoes over their blistered skin and down their parched throats for some respite from the burning heat. You will read of the member of a drill crew, whom I know to be typically very tough characters, that wanted to hold the hand of a friend in order that he didn't die alone. You'll also learn of incredible acts of humanity, where brave individuals gave their lives in order to try and save others. But mostly, you'll read of tragic, avoidable loss of life. And finally, let's put things into perspective here. These men didn't go to war. They went to their work. Everything you have in terms of safety offshore today, including the peace and security that your family enjoys whilst you're at your work, is owed to the men of Piper Alpha. And the hundreds more ordinary offshore workers, just like you, that paid the ultimate price for your safety. All of us must never forget their sacrifice. All of us, from the MDs to the new hire roosties, must go back to our workplaces and do all we possibly can prevent it ever happening again. Please play a part. Thank you.